We'll have the next question from the brothers Mike in the center.
My name is Rajesh. I work for an IT company. First, I would like to say Assalamu Alaikum. Sir, you are a versatile personality and you have knowledge of all the religion. And always you have said there is one and only Allah. And Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last messenger with the references and help of Hindu books. So now my question is, what about millions and billions of Hindus, Sikhs, Jain, Buddhists, they are praying at? Does their structure exist or there is only Allah and the Allah? Thank you.
The brother asked a very important question. He says that he has heard my talk and I speak for different religions and I try and prove that there is only one Allah and Prophet Muhammad is the final messenger, not only from the Quran, from the Hindu scriptures, from the Christian scriptures. So the question is, what about the millions and billions of non-Muslims, the Hindus, the Christians, that their structure yet exists? As far as the structure existing, if you go to the scriptures, all the scriptures that came before the Quran, in the passage of time, they have been manipulated, there has been corruption, there has been concoction. Therefore, if you apply the rule of logic and science, no scripture will pass the test except the Quran. But the beauty of all this is that even though the scriptures of the other religions have been changed, whether it be the Vedas, whether it be Ramayana, whether it be Mahabharata, whether it be Bhagavad Gita, whether it be the Bible, whether it be Dhammapada, what we realize that even in the changed form, even in the corrupted form, there are remnants. There are many verses which speak about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about Tawheed. Even though the scriptures have got corrupted, there are parts which yet say that Prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger. So what I say, that if they do research, and if they really want to be a good Christian, as Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14. I have many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself, all that here shall he say. He shall guide you to truth. He shall glorify me. So here Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is telling his followers that there is a messenger to come, Prophet Muhammad. If I give you the message now, you will not be able to grasp it. When he comes, he will guide you to all truth. So if a Christian has to be a true Christian, he has to follow the teachings of Prophet Muhammad. Same thing with the Hindus. There are many references of Muhammad besides Tawheed. It talks about the Kalki Avatar, the final messenger to come, Prophet Muhammad. So if you have to be a good practicing Hindu, it's mentioned in Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 5, verse number 7, verse number 9, verse number 15, that the Kalki Avatar has been described, that his father's name is Vishnu Yas, that the servant of Allah, Abdullah. Mother's name is Sumati, which means peace and serenity, that's Amina. He'll be born in the village by the name of Sambala, peaceful village, that's Makkah. He'll be born in a family of the chieftains of the village of Makkah. He will have four companions, talking about four Khulafa Rashideen. He will get the first revelation in a cave, that's Gare Hira. He will migrate northwards and come back. He went to Medina and came back. Several. So if you're a true Hindu, even though the scriptures have got corrupted, have been concocted, if you think the full scripture is the word of God, you have to follow the Kalki Avatar. You have to believe in the last and final messenger. So if you want to follow the structure, and if you do research, you will come to the same last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad. Same with Buddhism, same with Judaism, same with Christianity, same with Hinduism. So what I tell them, based on the verse of the Quran, of Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64. Ta'ala wila kalimatin sawa'im bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. What is different, we keep it aside. What is common, let us agree. Let us follow. The first thing is, Allah na'budu illallah. That he worship none but Allah. So what we realize, that what is different, we'll discuss tomorrow. What is common, let us agree to follow. Let us agree to follow what is mentioned in the Bible, in the Jewish scriptures, Christian scriptures, Hindu scriptures. God is one. He has got no idols. He has got no image. Idol worship is wrong. All the scriptures mention about the last and final messenger. So my question to them is, then why don't you follow it? Why don't you follow and believe only in one God? Don't do idol worship, worship him alone. And why don't you follow the last and final messenger? And my question to you, brother, is, if you're a Hindu, I think you're a Hindu. Okay? So why don't you follow your scripture which says that there's only one God? It says, Nata Sepati Masti, Sita Setara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19. in Yajurved, chapter 32, verse number 3, Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no Pratima. Pratima means Almighty God has got no image, has got no photograph, has got no painting, has got no portrait, has got no statue, has got no sculpture, has got no idol. I'm asking you, do you believe in one God? Do you believe?
I do.
Do you believe idol worship is wrong?
No.
So why don't you follow your Veda?
I tell you one thing. It's not necessary you need an idol or you need a picture or you need a light, you know. Idol is just created so you can focus, you know. It's for few people, those who cannot focus, for them, I mean, there is an idol so that you can focus properly.
Correct. This is what is said to me by the pundits. They tell me, Dr. Zakir Naik, we have read the scripture, we agree with you totally. Idol worship is wrong. But what happened? Those who are initial, you know, toddlers, in the early stage of life, you require idol to concentrate. When you reach higher consciousness, no idol is required. I tell them, we Muslims have reached the higher consciousness. We don't require idol. This is the explanation given to you by a pandit, not by a scripture. It is by a pandit. I tell them, isn't it mentioned idol worship is wrong? He says, we know. It is like my son, when he goes to second standard, the basics of maths is 2 plus 2 is 4. He says, son, 2 plus 2 is 5. You continue reading that. When you reach standard 10th, I will tell you 2 plus 2 is 4. I'll be the biggest fool. Because 2 plus 2 is equal to 4 is the basic equation of maths. God has got no idol is the basic thing of God. How can you teach the basics wrong in the lower classes and higher classes? This is told to you by your pundits and your scholars, not by your scripture. So I'm asking you, do you want to follow your scripture or do you want to follow your pandit?
I want to follow my scripture.
Correct. So scripture says, Almighty God has got no image, has got no idol. So do you yet believe in idol worship?
No.
Fine. So you used to believe, now you have stopped.
Excuse me. I said the idol is meant for the few people who cannot concentrate. I didn't say that I believe
in. So that means you want to diminish God? For example, brother, I am asking you a question.
Yes,
you
sir.
Are helping someone. What's your name?
Rajesh.
Rajesh. You are helping someone, maybe in Sri Lanka. Every month, you send him maybe 20,000 rupees, maybe 2,000 dirham for his education. He doesn't know who this Rajesh is. He says, who's this Rajesh? I don't know. So what does he do? He takes a cockroach and every day in the morning he says, Rajesh, thank you. Rajesh, thank you. Will you like it?
No.
Will you like it?
No.
Arey, but he doesn't know how Rajesh looks. So he's making a cockroach out of Rajesh. You will tell him, if you don't know how I look, at least take my name, it is sufficient. Why are you making a cockroach out of me? Now, God is so powerful, you want to make God into that small idol. If the idol falls, the idol breaks. The idol can't help himself, what will the idol help you? So what we say, don't belittle God, don't abuse God. If you don't know how he looks, only take his name. Why do you have to insult God? If he only says, Rajesh, thank you, without making a cockroach, you'll be more happy. And compared to you and us, we are human beings. God is, you cannot compare God. You cannot say he's million times more powerful. He is unlimited. You cannot compare God and human being. So how can you make God into an image and restrict him to an idol? It's insulting God. That's what the scriptures say, that he has got no pratima. You can give him attributes, but don't give him an image. Hindu scripture says that, Christian scripture says that, Quran says that. So now do you agree that even for concentration, making idol of God is wrong?
Could be.
Could be, not yet sure. Not yet sure, huh? Your scripture says don't make, your pandit says make. So do you want to follow your pandit or your scripture?
No scriptures.
And I'm giving you reference, I'm quoting in Sanskrit. If you don't know Sanskrit, open a dictionary, Pratima, you ask your pandit. There's a person, joker looking person wearing a cap and a coat and a tie. He is quoting scripture. Is it right? If you can't find the book, you can go to our center in Bombay IRF. We have all these scriptures. So I'm trying to get you closer to your scripture. So now you're convinced that idol worship is wrong.
See, my question was, what about millions and billions of people who are following Hinduism and Jainism,
brother,
Buddhism.
Millions of
does that exist or not? Okay, I agree with your thing. We should not do idol worship. But my question is, I mean, what about millions and billions? They have sentiments. They follow so much. So does that structure exist or it doesn't exist?
The structure exists, but it is wrong structure. The structure what
so that you mean to say everybody should follow Allah?
Everyone should follow the Creator.
See, but then do why don't you say Allah? Only Allah? Why because, can't we say God? Why can't we preach more about peace, love, humanity?
Very good. Why don't
rather than we talk about Hinduism?
Why don't I say God? I'll come to it. We'll come one by one. One question at a time, no problem. My plane is early in the morning, so I can stay. Why not call God? You know why? Because God can be played around with. Allah cannot be played. If you add S to God, it becomes God's. There is nothing like plural Allah. Kul hu Allahu ahad. Say is Allah one and only. If I add D-E-S-S to God, it becomes goddess, female God. There is nothing like male Allah or female Allah. You cannot play mischief with the Arabic word Allah. You can play mischief with the English word God. If I add father to God, becomes Godfather. He's my Godfather. He's my guardian. There's nothing like Allah Abba or Allah Father in Islam. If you add mother to God, becomes Godmother. There's nothing like Allah Ammi or Allah Mother in Islam. Allah is a pure Arabic word. You cannot play mischief. Same way, Khuda. You can have Khudadar. No, Ishwar becomes Parmeshwar. All these words can be played around with. You show any other word which cannot be played around, I will use it. No problem. It should not go against the definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm saying in Arabic, but when I speak to non-Muslims, I sometimes use God, knowing very well that God is not the appropriate translation of Allah. But while translating, even in Shahada, I'm using the word God, knowing very well it is not the correct definition. You are talking about, what about the millions and billions of people? Do they have the structure right, brother? Millions will come later on. I am bothered about you first. I am bothered about Rajesh. The million people, God will tell me when you met Rajesh. Why didn't you speak to Rajesh? Million people will come to later on, whether right or wrong. Fine, I am asking you, brother. I am bothered about you. I am concerned about you because I love you.
Thank you, thank you.
So I love you, therefore I am asking, are you convinced idol worship is wrong?
Yeah, I did say yes.
Yes, very good. Are you convinced that the last and final messenger is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, according to your scripture?
I don't have much knowledge, you know. Whatever, I mean, I listen more to you. I've read about your book.
You listen more to me than your scriptures.
No. I've read many scholars. I hear them, their cassettes, their videos. So I'm a little confused, you know, like, I don't know whom to believe, whom not to believe. But there are millions and billions of people, you know. So I don't know whether, I mean, see, I'm born in Hindu family. So it's very difficult to, you know, to transform or to convert or to change. But I was just confused, you know, because you always have seen that with examples of Gita and our books, you try to prove that there is Allah and there is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So I was just confused. What about us then? What we are praying at? Are we praying wrong way or what? Or we just have to, you know, like, follow you, what you say?
Don't follow what I'm saying, follow what God is saying. In your scripture, there's something like Shashtang. You know Shashtang? Shashtang in Sanskrit means 8 parts of the body. So the right way to pray in Hinduism is touching the 8 parts of your body. In Islam, our beloved Prophet said that when you do sujood, you touch your forehead, you touch your nose, you touch your 2 hands, your 2 knees, and the 2 feet, 8 parts. In your Hindu scripture also, the real way to pray is Shashtang, touching the 8 parts of your body. Don't get confused. I am giving you from your scripture. I want to remove your confusion. I am asking, when your pandits speak, tell them, go and check up, don't just follow me blindly. You say you listen to my speeches, you feel the speeches are logical. So when it is logical, when you go to school, teacher tells you 2 plus 2 is 4, she convinces you, agree.
So sir, when both the books are saying same, both the religions are saying the same, so why can't we speak about peace and love rather than talking about one religion?
That's what I'm talking about, peace. That follow one God who is your creator. If you want to get peace, you can only get peace by following the commandments of one creator. Though the religious books are different, what I'm trying to point out, the commonalities. I'm not criticizing Hinduism. I'm not criticizing Christianity. I can give a bigger speech of differences between Hindu scriptures and Islamic scriptures. I can give a bigger talk and a longer speech on differences between Bible and Quran. But my aim is not to spread enmity, my aim is to spread peace. So because my aim is to spread peace, I'm taking the commonalities and telling you the common point of both these religions, both these scriptures is believing in one God. I'm trying to spread peace. Islam means peace acquired by submitting your will to God. The ultimate peace is not only no war. No war, no fighting is only temporary peace. The ultimate peace is peace of mind, peace at heart, and peace in the next life. What I'm trying to propagate is not only peace in this world, peace in the next life. That's the reason I'm trying to get all the different human beings and telling them, do little research, spend little time, try and understand who our Creator is, try and submit your will to this Creator. What I request you to do is, submit your will to Almighty God. Follow the instructions of the last and final messenger, and then, inshallah, you'll get total peace.
Thank you.
Hope that answers the question. Mashallah, I thought it was a question-answer session, it turned into a shahada session.